the book, generally, or some of the ideas of, okay, so folks are sort of, I'm going to kind of, it's a pretty substantial book, so I'm going to do my best to kind of draw out the different periods in the coverage and also kind of how we can understand what the contributions are. So just to start off, in terms of who Walter Rodney was, first of all, he was a Guyanese revolutionary who published How Europe Underdeveloped Africa, which is really, you know, kind of a groundbreaking Marxist classic. And the book makes a decisive case that conditions of African poverty and inequality, what he termed underdevelopment, were the product of centuries of slavery, exploitation, and imperialism. And this, it's a pretty amazing book, and it goes in through in great detail about how Europe basically built industrial and colonial empires on the backs of African labor, devastating natural resources and African societies in the process. And ultimately, I think the book is about the urgent need for the overthrow of capitalism on the continent and worldwide, and the, about the urgent need to overthrow capitalism on the continent and worldwide, and the political tasks needed to bring about the systemic change. So, and I would say that the case is, and probably many of you are here in this room as well, because the case for this, I think, is no less urgent today. There's a lot of hype these days for people who've seen this in the business press about Africa rising, that it's a continent open for business, but massive inequality continues to dominate the continent, and the vast bulk of the wealth has accrued only to a tiny minority of the population. And in the midst of the current frantic boom for resources such as oil and minerals, poverty has barely been alleviated. An estimated 58% of the continent were living on less than $1.25 a day at the turn of the millennium. And I think looking at the Ebola crisis is a great way to understand of the past year, the ways in which the infrastructural failures of healthcare, of social service systems to meet even the basic needs, I think really underscores the stark reality of what Rodney was talking about a number of years ago when he denounced as a stolen and plundered continent. So today, Western multinationals and African elites have accumulated vast profits from their investments. It's no longer just Europe, I think, and some of it's obviously the U.S., but also African elites. Fuel and mineral exports from Africa have reached into the hundreds of billions, more than seven times the value of aid that actually flows into the continent. The U.S. gets more of its oil from Africa today than the Middle East, and is fighting to get ahead of Chinese competition, Africa's largest trading partner. There could be another whole talk about that area. But driven by these strategic interests, the U.S. now also has a military command called AFRICOM that it set up about a decade ago. There's thousands of troops in Africa. So given all that, Walter Rodney's legacy and contribution are thus all the more crucial, I think, for us today to understand the colonial past and its impact on this new scramble for Africa, the period of intensified exploitation and militarization today. Rodney was both an historian, but he was also a militant. And in the working class movement, particularly in his home country of Guyana, his leadership had a very long reach, both within pan-Africanist and Marxist currents, and within the revolutionary movement in Guyana. He was assassinated, actually, by agents of the Guyanese government almost exactly 35 years ago, just a few weeks ago. And he was described after his death by the great African novelist Wole Soyinka as he said, Walter Rodney was no captive intellectual playing to the gallery of global or international radicalism. He was clearly one of the most solidly ideologically situated intellectuals ever to look at colonialism and exploitation in the eye and where necessary spin in it, which I think is just a pretty awesome tribute to Rodney. So, and it's worth being said, by the way, that this book has been republished at least 8 times, so I think it's a testament to the continued interest and need for these ideas and this analysis. So I would argue that that the urgency in revisiting this Marxist classic is both because Rodney unflinchingly puts the responsibility of Africa's underdevelopment squarely on capitalism as a system as a whole, but also offers up a roadmap for struggle against it. So just to kind of start off with what Rodney is laying out here. Rodney spends quite a bit of time in the beginning of the book describing exactly what he means by development and underdevelopment and the devastating role capitalism has played in Africa and obviously in other parts of the underdeveloped world. And he makes it quite clear that when he's saying underdevelopment, he is talking about a condition that is actively produced by Europe and by historically through slavery and colonial relationships, that it's not an intrinsic property of Africa in and of itself. And he situates the underdevelopment within the contradictory process of capitalism, one that both creates value and wealth to exploiters while immiserating the exploited. And Rodney writes, the peasants and workers of Europe and eventually the inhabitants of the whole world paid a huge price so that the capitalists could make their profit from the human labor that always lies behind the machines. There was a period where the capitalist system increased the well-being of significant numbers of people as a byproduct, seeking out profits for a few. But today, and I would argue this is very true for today, the quest for profits comes into sharp conflict with people's demands that their needs should be fulfilled. So, Rodney argues, not only did the arrival of capitalist trade, especially the slave trade and production, threaten the ability to meet human need, but these relationships actually undermined and reversed development of African societies overall. So, and by development, really what Rodney understood was the building of politically and economically self-sustaining society. So in Rodney's view, Africa's level of development, for example, up through about the 15th century, was somewhat comparable to European development. So for example, looking at levels of urbanization and so on, but also that African societies, as he put it, were transitioning to from subsistence economies to different types of class stratified states. So just to turn specifically then to the slave trade, which is where he starts the analysis. So Rodney writes about how for centuries, even before the global dominance of capitalism of the late 18th century, African trade was central to the growth of trade and profits. Most importantly, the slave trade. And Rodney dates this from about 1445 to 1870, which turned Africa into the source of human raw materials for the new colonies in North America and the West Indies. And the people are probably familiar with the famous quote from Karl Marx, who wrote that the discovery of gold and silver in America, the extirpation, enslavement, and entombment in mines of the aboriginal population, the turning of Africa into a commercial warren for the hunting of black skins, signaled the rosy dawn of the era of capitalist production. These idyllic proceedings are the chief moments of primitive accumulation. On their heels treads the commercial war of European nations with the world great theater. So that's the famous quote by Marx. So traders originally came from Europe trying to break into African trade networks, and particularly originally they were looking for gold, but then shifted their focus to the slave trade, which really emerged with early colonization and the birth of plantation economies in the Western Hemisphere. So routes for the slave trade along the western and eastern coasts of the continent were established, built networks of traders that relied upon local African rulers, and the slave trade was implicated eventually in tens of millions of slaves captured and forcibly transported to the so-called New World and to Europe itself. And one of the things Rodney is trying to do is to really underscore how much this has been properly undercounted in terms of the scale of the forcible removal of Africans during this period. So 275,000 slaves were sent to America and Europe between 1450 and 1600, but in the 17th century, in response to the expansion of things like sugar plantations, cultivation in the Caribbean, and the new plantation economies, the numbers just jumped to over a million. So all told, a very conservative estimate of total slaves who made it to the New World is around 10 million. But again, as I said, that's considered conservative. The slave trade was reinforced by trading networks for other African materials as well. gold, as I mentioned, ivory, spices, timber, and other products, other commodities. But for both the earliest traders in Africa, like the Portuguese, as well as later competitors like Britain and France, slaves became the dominant commodity, especially by 1700. And this period was fraught with competition for territorial control over trade routes, with Britain eventually acquiring the upper hand over the course of several centuries. Trade with Africa was closely tied up with the growth of port cities such as Liverpool and key industrial centers. And here you see the beginning of what Rodney's talking about the way that development back in Europe began to grow, with the exchange of slaves for cheap industrial goods being the primary motor in building up profits for firms like the Royal Africa Company and others. And Rodney cites Eric Williams's Capitalism and Slavery. If people haven't read it, I think you have it in Haymarket, that argues that the slave trade provided England with the ability to make the investments that were needed really for the entire Industrial Revolution to take off, especially about the 18th century exports to Africa, as well as to European markets just had exploded. So with the massive expansion in the volume of the slave trade, it's also possible to see alongside of that, the development of African kingdoms that built up in those key trading areas in West Africa as they intensified their own role in the collaboration with the slave trade, such as the Oyo Kingdom and what was called the Slave Coast, where Benin is today, the Asante Kingdom and the Gold Coast, which is now where Ghana is, and parts of Central and East Africa, which are critical sources for the major powers involved in the slave trade. But from the start, argues Rodney, Europe was able to transform parts of Africa into what he describes as economic satellites. So even where there was development in those key areas, and part of the way that they were able to do that was through control of the seas, patterns of production and consumption within Europe, is the way he describes it. They literally dictated trade with Africa, such as what goods were traded, and so on. European countries centralized control also, not just over the trade itself, but also the laws and the policies that govern how that relationship unfolded. And they exploited, in addition, political divisions within Africa itself to further their advantage. So due to the markets provided by Africa for finished goods, as well as its export of raw materials, African trade stimulated innovation and technological development in Europe itself, such as shipbuilding. And this is a very critical point, a major theme in Rodney's book, is the way in which innovation unfolded as in a way to sort of spur for further development. So critically for Rodney, African trade not only developed economic growth, but created the capacity for future growth in what he called the metropoles, and what he meant the global centers of political and economic power and accumulation located mainly in Europe. So Rodney not only details the vast wealth accumulated by Europe through the slave trade, but he proceeds to show the devastating impact on the people of Africa itself, and again, it's the underdevelopment of Africa. So first and foremost is the labor loss to Africa because of the slave trade. And he writes, the European slave trade was exerting a retarding influence on economic and social relations. Slave trade was economically totally irrational from the viewpoint of African development, exerting a retarding influence on economic and social relations, even in regions that were not directly impacted by slavery themselves, because it had a distorting impact on the entire economic and social system. So Rodney is arguing here that even if slavery were morally wrong, there's the right wing argument that slavery is somehow beneficial, right? That somehow it kind of lifted all boats for Europeans and Africans alike. And he says that's actually his book is really kind of an attempt to kind of debunk that entire myth. And he says, you know, the wealth, in consumer goods, for example, that Africans acquired, which is something that's, used as an example, tended to be either completely low quality or just geared towards sending weapons to Africa, or luxury goods that only the, tiny handful of African elites could use. So hardly a way to contribute to the development of Africa as a whole. The range of exports from Africa gradually narrowed as trade with Europe increased, and so it was mainly focused on a few commodities. But in the process, local production was really crowded out by the flood of cheap European imports that that widened across the continent. And so technological development stagnated through that process because it forced the over-focus on trade in Africa to the detriment of actual production of economic innovation and created a barrier to innovation within Africa itself. So again, as Rodney put it, a loss of development opportunity, and this is of the greatest importance. The lines of economic activity attached to foreign trade were either destructive, as slavery was, or at best purely extractive. What he means by extractive is literally extracting minerals and wealth out of the ground and shipping it away. Okay, so as we've seen, Africa from the 15th century was vital to the economic success and competition between European powers, but this was vastly more so in sort of the next historical era, which is called the scramble for Africa. People may be familiar with this from, and Rodney dates this roughly from that 1870 to World War I, where European powers really almost literally divided the continent between themselves in the pursuit of power and profit. And the racist ideology that was developed to justify this was very explicit. The conquering of a dark continent, through the forces of civilization and so on, justified European imperialism, and also justified the sort of missionizing of the continent as well, the need to bring Christianity to a continent that's shrouded in savagery and commerce to a people that had no societies of their own. So for example, there's he quotes a colonial administrator who says, if you read the history of any part of the Negro population of Africa, you will find nothing but a dreary recurrence of tribal wars, an absence of everything which forms a stable government, and year after year, generation after generation, century after century, these tribes go on obeying no law but that of force, and consequently never emerging from the state of barbarism in which we find them at present. And Rodney's book has already demonstrated how fundamentally untrue as well as racist that is. So although the slave trade and other commodity trading with Africa were crucial engines of growth for the colonial powers, it really wasn't until the late 18th century and the 19th century that capitalism as a dominant economic system emerged. And Rodney follows Marx in his emphasis on these new global relations of production and exchange, as well as the ways that capitalism as a world system driven by profit transformed also not just economies, but human interaction, social relations, ideology everywhere that it spread. The 20th century revolutionary Lenin then built on Marx's analysis of the dynamics of capitalism to describe imperialism and the motor by which capitalism tends to expand beyond the confines of a single political system or national borders, and that the development tends to spill over into conflicts over further accumulation and control abroad. So by the second half of the 19th century, European powers were in an increasingly sharp competition for an ever-increasing need for markets for their goods, for capital investment. And the 19th century scramble for Africa really grew out of the struggle between the newer European powers and older ones. And the need to grab whatever natural resources it could from Africa, literally on the cheap, to sustain the growth of industry back at home. So as described by Lenin in Imperialism, the High Stage of Capitalism, quote, the tremendous boom in colonial conquest begins after the 1870s, and the struggle for the territorial division of the world becomes extraordinarily sharp. The more capitalism is developed, the more strongly this shortage of raw materials is felt, the more intense the competition and the hunt for raw materials, and the more desperate the struggle for the acquisition of colonies. So Rodney was very influenced by this understanding of imperialism and saw the impetus for the scramble for Africa in the partition that happened in Berlin in 1885, the famous conference of the world, of the rulers of the world at that time, being spurred by the development of imperialistic forces and what Rodney understood to be the limits that were placed on the scope for expansion within national economies, and that the idea that they were then looking to colonial regions where they would face little resistance, they got to expanding capitalism further. So in 1873, there was an economic crash, and this actually further intensified this whole dynamic and intensified competition over resources in the scramble for colonies. And so at around that time, that's where you start to hear about Europeans dispatching what they called explorers, you know, Livingston and all of that, who sought trade concessions from African chiefs, a lot of times through fraudulent treaties that hand over rights to European sponsors, and later just using just flat out military domination. And in 1876, the European powers, this is right kind of the launch of the official scramble for Africa, control only about 10% of the continent, but by the turn of the century, they virtually the entire continent was partitioned. So, and dominated by Europe. And this is, you know, approximately, just to give a sense, this is approximately a fifth of the globe at that time, 9 million square miles, carved up into dozens of colonies by the five largest powers in the world. So, now just to say that this annexation was not just sort of accepted without resistance by any means by Africans themselves, there was fierce resistance. But European colonialism, they used the most brutal torture, warfare, deception, and so on to subdivide the continent into and to set it up in ways that further their political and economic needs, and had certainly was not done on any kind of logic or understanding of the local languages, cultures, societies, or any other factors. They were able to extract wealth regardless of any of those kind of relationships. And partly, again, this was done by building up a network of African rulers that they were that were willing to collaborate with them. And so the result of this was the subjugation of the continent through not just territorial conquest, but also forced labor, and literally the loss of tens of thousands of lives. And so, have people read King Leopold's Ghost? Okay, so people read that, you have a little bit of an understanding of, you know, this was it's a history of the rubber plantations in the Congo and the sort of the literally the brutality in which the multinationals who relied on that rubber and so on, you know, put forward to. To accomplish that. So as Rodney describes, he says, the colonization of Africa and other parts of the world formed an indispensable link in a chain of events which made possible the technological transformation of the base of European capitalism. So you have, for example, like copper from the Congo, iron from West Africa, chrome from Rhodesia and South Africa, and so on. And then you think about those minerals and what they're able to do in terms of innovation, scientific development, and development of productive capacity. It really took this to a whole another level. And not only it built and put scientific advancement in the interest of furthering massive industrial complexes and so on. So, but along the way, this created its own competition, because part of where these this investment went was not just the expansion of technology and so on, but also the development of weaponry to respond to these intensified economic competition. So you have, you know, essentially the innovation ended up translating into further weaponry and so on that spilled into spilled over into conflicts in Africa, but also impacted the nature of World War I and World War II. So you think about, for example, like things like steel-plated ships that allowed the world to be militarized in a new way. That comes out of that particular period. The development of things like machine guns and so on launched a really brutal arms race, essentially, and a new chapter in just unbelievable violence and horror, both in Europe and as I said, that they used to facilitate the plunder in Africa itself. Rodney has a great example in here. People may know the multinational company Unilever, and they produce all kinds of household products, including soap and such. So one of the things they did, and it goes through this case study, is that they were extracting palm oil that they were using to build soap and all these kinds of products. But one of the things that happened as a sort of happenstance, the byproduct of extracting palm oil creates the raw materials to make explosives and so on. And so part of this was, there was very much of a synergy between developing, extracting minerals and also building wealth, but also the development of these sort of the industries of militarization. So it's just that the book's worth reading just even for some of these case studies in and of itself. But as I said, there were, just to say, I mean, Rodney does continue, you know, he talks about some of the state building that had begun to develop before the arrival of the slave trade and so on, that some of the, really in this period, some of those states and empires that had continued to sort of exist and so on were really, at this point, became, you know, further undermined. But in the process, he taught there was the beginnings of a tiny layer of African elites, early nationalists, and Pan-Africanists that did start to emerge in that period. So it's a part in terms of understanding some of the political currents at that time. So I've talked about the vast amounts of wealth that's kind of accrued to the industrialists and so on. Certainly the banking industry, like Barclays, which is still around today, made huge amounts of wealth off of this. But there's also it's also important to understand like the role that the colonial administration as a state a state apparatus performed, because the way they set it up was in terms of facilitating this, they set up things like taxation that literally where Africans were then compelled to pay their own exploitation and repression. They created policies to facilitate this exploitation, things like forbidding Africans to grow cash crops so that they were then compelled to not just sort of sell their labor as wage workers, but vulnerable to literally being forcibly constricted into work. So, and things that were called by the colonialists public works, which is sort of a nice euphemism for the infrastructure, which did enable to facilitate extraction. So railways to get that rubber from the center inland out to the coast, and all of that kind of thing. For example, in Sierra Leone, thousands and thousands of peasants were conscripted into building a railway to facilitate the movement of raw materials out, including children. And they had a policy where that they called, that you were required to give up free days, which is meaning, free to the capitalists, to contribute your labor every year. And this was resulting in thousands and thousands of deaths for children and adults alike. So there's a number of other examples that Rodney goes through which are really excellent in terms of kind of illustrating this. The picture in South Africa at the time, the wars between the Anglo-Zulu Wars, which they call them, which essentially ended up ceding control of South Africa to Britain, and which took over by the end of the Boer Wars of 1902. And South Africa is very important because there you see some of the sharpest contradictions within imperialism because of the vast amounts of super profits that came from that region. The fortunes that were made there, this is Rodney talking about gold and diamonds, people like Cecil Rhodes, that Rhodesia was then named after, Rhodesia now Zimbabwe, the mining companies that made out like bandits, manganese, gold, uranium, diamonds, and so on and so forth, which were all, again, brought to the surface by African labor. So part of the way that Rodney structures this book is that he talks about kind of both sides. He talks about the development for Europe, but then the underdevelopment of both of these historical processes. So he really goes through as well about how then that same process sort of actively underdeveloped Africa. And I'll just sort of touch on some of the points he makes very quickly. In terms of the process of turning Africa into a conveyor belt for raw materials, the British and the French, the main colonial powers, had different kind of approaches to the African population in terms of how they set up the administration and so on, but in no instance, that Rodney is very clear on this, that did they allow for any really kind of African self-rule. The French had a different approach, that the British gave a little bit more latitude in that area. The French literally destroyed all the indigenous political systems, established their own networks of administrators and so on. And not only, as I said, were roads set up to facilitate the extraction of raw materials, but also to facilitate the use of forces of repression, to police the indigenous population, and so on, and to, you know, as I said, to force people to build, to grow cash crops. So really in terms of the kind of the underdevelopment right there, in terms of living under repressive rule, that was sort of, that's chief among what Rodney's talking about. But also that, again, because the whole continent was geared towards extraction and trade and so on, that none of the manufacturing, the processing of raw materials that allowed for growth and innovation in Europe, none of that happened in Africa. It happened exclusively overseas. So, and not only that, but Africans were also discriminated against in almost every area of economic life. Wages were very low, and they were able to justify that by saying that any kind of skilled labor that was needed in Africa, they brought in European workers to do that, but by and large, the skilled work was done elsewhere. So, the way that Rodney makes that very clear, that's restrictions were put on African capacity to make the maximum use of its economic potential. Those are his words. So again, to go back to the sort of myth about, I talked about the myths of the way slavery benefited, supposedly gave some benefits to Africans and so on. Again, similarly in under colonialism, that there was a lot, that supposedly, well, Africans were illiterate before the Europeans arrived and so on. And in fact, as Rodney goes through, Rodney's very interested in education and the ways in which the colonialists set up educational systems that they suppressed education for the majority, that it was of the most narrow form, if it was available really at all, which was in very rare instances. In the Congo, for example, there were only 16, which is what, half the people in this room, secondary school graduates at the time of independence out of a total population of 13 million. Okay? So you just sort of magnify that in terms of the skill and the intellectual capacity that's lost there. Likewise, in Mozambique, there was not one doctor that was trained, African doctor, in the 500 years of Portuguese colonialism. So this process really, and alongside of that, the decimation or the complete underdevelopment of social services, healthcare, and so on, just left complete devastation across the whole continent. Life expectancy had been higher, it plummeted, the ecological devastation spread across much of the continent and so on, and really just the most minimal services available at all. Rodney has a wonderful quote in here. He says, colonialism had only one hand. He's arguing against the sort of benefits, pros and cons. He said colonialism had only one hand, and it was a one-armed bandit. So, really what Rodney's trying to say is that, trying to poke through and undermine these myths to say that really the whole idea of investment in foreign capital in colonial Africa was really a deception. And this is how Rodney concludes, that it was actually the capital and the wealth that was derived from the slave trade derived that helped build up the colonial systems, and then were supposedly kind of repackaged as profits and come back the next year. But that there was nothing, what he says is that there was nothing foreign about the capital in colonial Africa, but the only thing that was foreign about it was its ownership and not its initial source. And that's, I think, a really important point. So in that time, this is getting into sort of the early and mid 20th century, you start to see the resistance to colonialism and to this exploitation. Workers went on strike, participated in boycotts, joined nationalist organizations. Some of them were illegal, Really, though, like starting in the Depression of the 1930s, the economic crisis worldwide just kind of intensified that resistance because of the collapse of the collapse of raw materials really put a lot of pressure on, right? I need to speed up, on African peasants to rebel. And but despite that, it took several more decades of struggle and resistance on the part of Africans to really force Europeans to remove their hold and so on. So, okay, I need to sort of speed up a little bit because I want to talk a little bit about some of the. Okay, so I'm gonna have to skip Frantz Fanon. Hopefully, people went to. Okay, well, did people go to the talk earlier today? But really, I mean, Rodney shared a lot of Fanon's sort of sentiments about the role of the African elites, and he used some great terms like. Puppets being operated on by remote control from the metropolitan capital and so on, and really called them a group of African sellouts. This is Rodney quote saying is the definition of underdevelopment. So okay, now what political roadmap? I'll try and finish in about 5 or 6 minutes. But in terms of the political roadmap that Rodney offers from this, fascinating and devastating picture and way forward for development and true liberation in Africa. First of all, Rodney rejected the idea that development of production industry and a substantial working class was possible within capitalism. And that's, I think, something that is probably the most important point to take away from this in terms of what the solution is. Imperialism, because he believed that imperialism inevitably would thwart growth in the third world because of just the deep-rooted nature of imperialism that would inevitably just undermine the initiative and the ability of people to rise up and throw it off within the confines of capitalism itself. But for Rodney, who also was very much in keeping with some of the currents of Maoism and so on during that day, unfortunately, saw socialism though as being much that really equating it with nations like Russia, China, North Korea as examples. And this is a quote from Rodney, where socialism has advanced on capitalism's weakest flanks in the sector that is exploited, oppressed, and reduced to dependency. Socialism has reinstated economic equality. So, like many other revolutionaries in the 60s and 70s, Rodney, I would say, made the mistake of equating socialism merely with state ownership of the economy and planned development. And actually, Rodney believed that about one-third of the globe at that time was socialist. So if socialism can be achieved by extricating from the capitalist system, so for Rodney and others, he saw African socialism, it's for example like Tanzania's Ujamaa model, which is essentially an idea of community-based or sort of a peasant-based socialist cooperative model as really a kind of model for the underdeveloped world. And so here, Rodney was influenced by the ideas of C.L.R. James, a Caribbean Marxist, and Pan-Africanist is also a talk on C.L.R. James, I think, at the conference later, in the way that the applicability of a Marxist approach to the specifics of the African context, and along with that, the key role of the peasantry as unique, as a revolutionary force. So here also, Rodney was influenced by people, the dependency theorists, such as André Linderfrank. I don't have a lot of time to get into that, but who argued the development in the so-called periphery, meaning the underdeveloped world, was proportional to the degree of independence from the metropolis. So, in other words, the model, the model of state-directed national development as a model for growth, however, was proven, and this is particularly in the years after following Rodney's death, but was proven not to be a viable model. National development in Africa was unable to overcome the legacies of colonialism and weak economies, and with many African states then subject to neoliberal structural adjustment reforms like the IMF and World Bank policies that just brought about crushing third world debt and austerity. So Rodney talks about something what he calls development by contradiction, meaning the contradictions within African society that are only resolvable by Africans regaining their sovereignty as a people. And here I think it's also where Rodney is attempting to lay out what he sees, where he sees the source of social change lying. So first, he does acknowledge the disproportionate weight and importance of the small African working class as a more stable base of resistance as compared to other sections of society. He argues that production proceeded on a different path than in Europe, where the destruction of agrarian craft economies increased productive capacity through the development of factories and a mass working class that did not happen in Africa. And as he says, the process was distorted, local craft industry was destroyed, industry was not developed, as I've talked about before, more restricted to the lowest and most unskilled work. So what he's saying is that, what he says is that capitalism in the form of colonialism failed to perform in Africa the tasks which it had performed in Europe. And so, Rodney concludes that even though the working class is a stable force in African society, it is too small and too weak to play a liberatory role in that current period. And so he kind of, I think Rodney's a little bit ambivalent about this. I think that he sort of almost reluctantly identifies the intelligentsia for that particular, as kind of the liberatory force. And he says, altogether, the educated played a role in African independence struggles far out of proportion to their numbers, because they took it upon themselves and were called upon to articulate the interests of all Africans. They were also required to focus on the main contradiction, which was between the colony and the metropole, the contradiction being the educated and the colonials were not the most profound. However, the differences between the two, as long as at that time, were decisive. So in other words, for Rodney, that's the key, that's kind of the key relationship there. And so the leadership of the intelligentsia, though, was fraught with a lot of problems, including problems that Rodney recognized. He said that most African leaders of the intelligentsia were frankly capitalists and shared fully the ideology of their bourgeois masters. As far as the mass of peasants and workers were concerned, the removal of overt foreign rule actually cleared the way towards a more fundamental appreciation of imperialism. So I think that that's a little bit where Rodney sees, kind of in a more hopeful sense, the process unfolding. But that, again, he didn't see the potential for the working class to play a revolutionary role in the immediate term. And I'm starting to wrap up. But he also believed, and this is important, that the backwardness of white workers in Europe and other parts of the Western world, or what have you, actually made unity impossible in practice. Even though he believed in theory that the chief divide across the globe was between capitalists and workers. And he says that, he talks about how surplus from Africa was used to offer a few more benefits to European workers and serve as a bribe to make the latter less revolutionary. The bribe came in form of increased wages and better working conditions and so on. But he also, Rodney would made the point to say that these benefits were minimal. And he said European workers have paid a great price for the few benefits which accrued to them as crumbs at the colonial table. So all of this creates a little bit of a contradictory framework for Rodney. He hoped that this stage of development that relied upon the intelligentsia was just transitional. I think that, though, his formulation does lead to some problems, because what it does is that it falls into a little bit of what I would say is a stagist formulation, that you have to postpone the possibility of international revolution to a future date after sort of other revolutionary tasks in the here and now, the national liberation struggles and so on, are accomplished. So in other words, that the middle class can lead the movements for decolonization, the liberation for the majority needs to be put off to potentially a future date. And I think that, just to wrap up here, people may be familiar with the Russian revolutionary Leon Trotsky and his ideas about permanent revolution. And I think that Trotsky has some insights that can actually, you know, help us extend some of Rodney's insights and analysis as well, because Rodney argued that the potential, I mean, not Rodney, Trotsky argued that the socialists must see the potential for working class struggle in a broader sense, And that the linkages between different areas of Africa are uneven, and linkages between Africa and the rest of the globe, and that's where the opportunity for global solidarity and kind of revolutionary potential exists. So, for example, a cash crop worker in rural Africa may in fact be relatively isolated, may be politically unorganized, but Trotsky would argue that their links to workers in key sectors of Africa, because of their shared power as workers at the point of production, provides the possibility for shared struggle in a wider sense. So you have workers in places like oil workers in Nigeria, platinum workers in South Africa, that do actually have their hands on the levers of immense power at the point of production, and exist in a relationship of solidarity and of economic ties with the more disparate sections of African peasants and workers and so on. So here we see the possibility for revolutionary change in Africa that doesn't just reduce us to, you know, hoping we'll move to the next stage of the process, but actually presents a dynamic possibility for how struggle can unfold. So I think to me, like, being able to talk about Rodney and this and his contribution has just been, it's really an immense contribution. Again, I said this at the beginning, and it's and I think really just that he was just on a biographical note to end that he was only 38 when he was killed, and so really, I mean, the idea of like it's really a tragic tragedy in terms of a life that was taken too soon, and I think that it seems to me that some of the movements that are arising today or revitalizing today are looking to Rodney's work, not just How Europe Underdeveloped Africa, but other contributions that he made about the Guyanese working class and other the working class struggle in general. So, I mean, he really, I think, left to the next generation, and there's been, a couple generations since he died, but really this kind of unflinching commitment to the need to overthrow capitalism, the need to overthrow imperialism, and I think that, and to say that it's not a debt that Africa owes Europe, which is how, but it's really a debt the other way around, that Africa is owed a debt from the developed world, and we owe, I would say, a debt to Rodney for his insights and really giving us the tools to understand that the West role in underdeveloping Africa. Such a critical chapter of our history. Thank you.